Hello, I am Bob, and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining channel. And in this build series episode, I'm going to cover my Bitcoin miner powered clothes dryer. So with that, let's get started. But before getting on with the video, I want to mention some sponsors of the channel, the first being BRAIINS. So BRAIINS has just announced their new BMM100 mini miner. And if you are just starting out learning about Bitcoin and Bitcoin mining, this is the perfect miner for you. The BMM100 mini miner can run off of any household power source using only 40 watts. Just plug it in and connect it to the internet and start mining. You can explore what it's like to generate hash rate, join a mining pool, and to mine Bitcoin. It is the perfect starter platform for you to start your own home Bitcoin mining journey. Just click on the link below to order your new BRAIINS BMM100 mini miner. Now my next sponsor is Scott's Crypto Mining and the Build-A-Mine Bootcamp. In the Build-A-Mine Bootcamp, you'll learn everything you need to know to launch your first megawatt of Bitcoin miners in less than 3 months. The Build-A-Mine Bootcamp is taught by Scott himself, and you'll be joined by other entrepreneurs and business owners like you who want to learn how to stack more sats faster through Bitcoin mining on an industrial scale. To get in on this fantastic opportunity, just click the link in the description below. And last up is the mining hardware supplier for the channel, Altair Bitcoin Mining Solutions. Altair is your one-stop shop for any mining hardware you might need. They have everything from the latest and greatest miners to every hashboard, cable, and part you might need to repair your existing hardware or build your own 120-volt home-built miner. Altair has years of experience working in the Bitcoin mining industry, running their own mining farm, and they've worked with all different scales of mining operations. Altair is based in the US and has top-rated customer support. And so if you have any question about anything at any time, they are there to help you out. Altair is a huge supporter of the home mining community, so if you're looking to buy your next miner or miner parts for your home setup, check out their website at the link below. You'll find pretty much everything you'll ever need. Okay, so in my last episode, I covered the basics of heating a clothes dryer with an immersion Bitcoin mining setup. This included covering a few challenges to make this work, including managing the heat flow between the miner and dryer, managing the airflow into the dryer itself, and modifying the dryer electronics. I have a link above to that episode. It's definitely worth the watch to get up to speed. And so in this episode, I'm going to start putting that design information into action and see if I can build a Bitcoin-powered dryer. And the first thing to cover is safety. When it comes to this build, there's a couple things to really be careful about. First is house fires. Clothes dryers are one of the leading causes of fires in the home. Now, with a Bitcoin miner powered dryer, the temperatures involved are going to be significantly lower than normal dryer temperatures. But if a dryer is modified to work with a Bitcoin miner and then returned to normal operation, the airflow in and out of the dryer might be modified enough to create overheating problems, and lint may have built up in certain locations to where a fire is now more likely. The second safety issue is electrical shock. A typical dryer is wired to a home circuit with an output of 240 volts and 30 amps. That's a lot of electrical power. Modifying the electronics of a dryer means that all of that power is not going where it was safely designed to go. If modifications are not done correctly, this could easily create the condition where a high-powered electrical shock could severely injure or kill the operator of these systems. And so when it comes to the rest of the content of this video, treat this as me just explaining what I've done with my dryer. The content presented here is not any recommendation, guidance, or instruction on what you should do with your appliances. Now, the first part of the system to build is the miner immersion tank and pump. And when it came to selecting my miner, I decided to use one of my S19J Pro miners that were being used to heat my water, my house, and my garage. I removed the miner from my tank and swapped it with a brand new S21 I got from the sponsor of this channel, Altair Mining Solutions. And in an upcoming episode, I'm going to cover how to prep an S21 for immersion mining, so hit that subscribe button below. It will make sure you don't miss any great content coming your way. Now, when it comes to the pump and tank, I'm going to use the same homemade tank and pump from my previous 120-volt budget build. When I designed and built that system, the goal was to build something that would handle a 120-volt single-board miner, but I also had this dryer build in mind. The tank and pump can both handle a full-sized S19 miner running at normal speeds, so that design should work great for this dryer heating setup. And if you want to see the details of how that system came together, I have a link to my 120-volt budget immersion miner build playlist above. With the miner, tank, and pump ready to go, the next step was to size and build a radiator that would cool the dielectric fluid and heat up the air going into the dryer. Now, in a normal immersion setup, a dry cooler is used to cool the fluid, and this is just a really big radiator with a big, high-powered fan. But as I noted in the previous episode, the airflow going through a dryer is super low. It's only about 120 to maybe 130 cubic feet per minute. Also, the air going into the dryer needs to heat up to at least 120 degrees Fahrenheit to be useful to dry laundry. And so a normal dry cooler design isn't going to work here. Instead, for this dryer setup, I built a radiator stack. The way this works is the hot fluid enters the radiator at the bottom of the stack. As it moves up through each successive radiator, it gives off its heat to the air, which is slowly moving in the opposite direction down through the stack. This counterflow design should work well at these really low air flow rates and should maximize the heat transfer between the dielectric fluid and air. This should produce the highest output air temperature going to the dryer and the lowest output fluid temperature going back to the miner. Now, for my setup, I wanted to keep the radiators small to keep the airflow through the radiators from stalling out, and I was also limited by some space constraints in my laundry closet. So I settled with a stack of 4 8-inch by 8-inch water-to-air radiators. Each radiator is about 4 inches thick and has 3 rows of copper tubing, giving me a combined radiator 16 inches thick with 12 rows of copper tubing. Now, I got these radiators from Outdoor Furnace Supply, but there are quite a few other manufacturers of similar radiators out there. I used some foam gasketing material and metal straps to build and seal the stack, and I soldered copper piping to connect the inlets and outlets of the radiators together. With the stack assembled, I added a ducting adapter to the bottom radiator to make it easy to attach to 4-inch ducting. I also added PEX adapters to the inlet and outlet of the stack to connect to my immersion tank. With the immersion miner side of the build done, the next step was to focus on the dryer. Now, I could have worked on my existing dryer, but since this was my first attempt at building something like this, I didn't know what to expect. I didn't know how long it would take to build this out, and I might have made a mistake that could have destroyed my one and only working dryer. So I decided to buy a second dryer for this build. Now, the nice thing about clothes dryers is if you know where to look, you can pick up a really cheap donor appliance. And that's because when a typical homeowner buys a new washer or dryer, they usually buy them in pairs. But the thing is, clothes dryers last a lot longer than the washers. Dryers are very simple in design and are relatively easy to repair, and so when folks buy a new washer and dryer set, the washer might be past its useful life, but the dryer can still be in great shape. Now, the big box stores aren't interested in making money off of used appliances, so when they pick up old appliances after installing new models, they often just throw them out. But smaller local appliance shops will often resell these older dryers through their service departments at a high discount, which creates a great opportunity. So I went down to my local mom and pop appliance shop and looked for a used Sears, Kenmore, or Whirlpool model. These particular models are extremely reliable. They are very easy to work on, it's easy to find parts, and there are tons of YouTube and other resources out there for understanding how to take them apart and how they work. And so I was easily able to find an old but reliable dryer for my build. It cost me only $250, and that included delivery. With my dryer delivered, the next step was rewiring the dryer for mining. And as I noted in the last episode, I need the main functions of the dryer to keep working. I need the appliance to turn on and off, I need the drum to spin, and I don't want to turn off any of the safety mechanisms built into the dryer. Also, I wanted to be able to switch back to normal drying mode in case my mining setup needed to be taken offline or if it didn't work. So I opened up the dryer and looked through its electrical circuit design. I figured the simplest way to wire my miner to the clothes dryer was to tap into the dryer right at the existing heating element connections. This way, all of the existing controls, timers, safety switches, sensors, and other electronics are kept as is, and all I'm doing is rerouting the electrical power from the heating element to the miner. Here's a diagram of my circuit design. I used a high current 30 amp switch to enable switching between the miner and normal heating operation. I also added a line to the neutral power connection to add a 120 volt outlet that will turn off with the dryer. This outlet will be used to power my fluid pump and my dryer vent fan. I mounted the switch and outlet in standard electrical boxes mounted directly to the side of my dryer. I then used an air conditioner whip cable to connect the dryer to an electrical box mounted nearby on the wall. In this external electrical box, I split the 120 volt power coming from the dryer into the two cables needed to power the S19 miner. I also added safety fuses to protect from shorts and a power meter to monitor miner performance. With the immersion cooling and dryer electrical modifications in place, the last part of the build was to route the airflow from the miner through the dryer. Now, the fan within the dryer is only built to pull in air through the small openings in the dryer housing. The dryer fan as is really doesn't have the power to pull air through my radiator stack and down the ductwork and into the dryer, so I need to help it out. I found a small 4-inch dryer booster fan rated at 130 cubic feet per minute and installed this right below the radiator stack. This will pull the air through the radiators and push the miner heated air through a 4-inch duct into the dryer. And to ensure this hot air will make its way to the dryer drum, I cut a hole into the side of the dryer right next to the heating element and attached a ducting adapter. I used foam weather stripping between all of the dryer panels and aluminum tape on the larger openings to seal the dryer so that it would only pull air in from this new opening. And with everything ready, I built a small shelf above my modified dryer and installed the radiator stack, tank, and ducting. Now, the miner will get pretty hot, and I don't want my laundry area to get too warm, so I put in some insulative paneling to enclose the miner and radiator. And with everything now in place, the next step was to fill the tank with dielectric fluid, plug in the miner, pump, and fans, fill the dryer with some damp towels, and see if it works. And unfortunately, this first iteration of my build didn't work that well. I started up the dryer with my electrical switch in Bitcoin mode, sending power to my miner. The dryer drum was rotating, my immersion tank was circulating fluid, my booster fan was blowing warm air into the sealed dryer housing, and my S19 was mining Bitcoin at full speed. But that didn't last that long. Very quickly, my miner started to overheat. So I had to back off on miner power, and this was super easy to do with the BRAIINS OS. Now, BRAIINS is a sponsor of the channel, but even if they weren't, I'd still be using them. With their firmware, it was super easy to really push this setup to its limits to try and make it work. I reduced the target power all the way down to 1700 watts. I turned off two of the three hashboards, and I set my max operating temperature to up around 85 degrees C, which is really pushing the S19 miner to its extremes. But even running a single hashboard at less than 1000 watts and allowing it to operate at 85 degrees C, my S19 miner was still overheating. Also, I measured the output temperature at the end of the miner ductwork, and throughout all of the different power adjustments I tried, I was only seeing an air temperature of around 115 degrees Fahrenheit, which was way too cool to dry anything. In fact, I opened the dryer a few times along the way, and the damp towels were always just cold and wet and not drying at all. So my first attempt at heating my dryer with Bitcoin mining was kind of a failure. And to some degree, I was expecting this. If you watch my past build episodes, you'll find pretty much every build I've attempted didn't initially work as I had hoped. And this is part of the process of using Bitcoin mining heat around the home. You design the setup as best as you can, you build and give it a try, and then you adapt and rework as needed. And this is something I really work to capture in this channel. I want to show you what it really takes to make these home-built systems work. And this build is following the same path. I learned a lot from my first attempt, and I've been working on improving the design, trying to make it work. And if you want to see my next steps in troubleshooting this build, or catch the details of my other home heating builds, click here.